looking around, I see some of you singing with a choir again. Well, guess what? Now you're going to join it. Remain seated at this first song, 311. This world is not my home. We'll stay seated for the first song. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, in this world anymore. How many are singing? Are you singing? Raise your hand if you're singing. Just didn't sound like it, you know? Maybe it's because you're sitting down. I don't know. We'll try another stanza and we'll see. All right, here we go. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know He'll take me through, though I am meek and poor, and I can't be at home in this world anymore. Oh, Lord, you know. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door. I have a loving Savior up in glory land. I don't expect to stop until I with Him stand. He's waiting now for me in heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? Anymore. Would you stand together? We're going to sing that last verse standing so I can hear you better. Then we'll sing that next song. Give it your all now. Let's sing it. Verse number 4.
Just up in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs are sweet as praise drift back from heaven's shore.
Watch me now.
Oh Lord, no, I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? From heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
We're not supposed to feel at home down here, amen? We'll be feeling at home when we get to heaven, amen? 5:14. Is your name written down when the roll is called up yonder? If you're going to feel at home in heaven, then you better know Jesus. Amen. That's the only way you're going to get there. Let's sing it together.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. On the bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall come, and the glory of His resurrection share, when His chosen ones shall gather home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder.
Better watch it, or some of you might be there sooner than you think. You know, you'll just drop right there, but you won't be down long before you're going up. Amen. Let's sing verse number 3. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn to setting sun. Let us talk of all His wondrous love and care. And the roll is called of yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called of yonder, 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 I'll be there.
People said?
Amen.
Amen. Well, that's a good time of singing. We're glad to have you here with us tonight. Had a great service this morning. Hey, Kevin, good to see you here. How you feeling, man? Good. Well, praise the Lord. Good to have him back. He had neck surgery, and I'm glad that he's well enough to come back to church. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Well, let's bow our heads, ask God to bless in the service tonight. Dear Lord, we're grateful to be here in the house of God. We're thankful for decisions made here this morning, for the good number here in God's house. Father, for bringing these folks back, may we rejoice together here in this place and sing your praises. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. We are glad to have you here tonight. If you're here for the very first time, this is a first time with us at Liberty Baptist, you're welcome. We're glad to have you here tonight. Our ushers have a packet of information about our church. And they'd like to put one of those in your hand. If you haven't received one of those packets of information about our church, slip your hand up. Anyone need one of those right up here in the front? Anyone else? First time here, they're going to put one of those packets in your hand. And inside that packet, you'll find a card. And if you'll fill that card out, then they will have a gift for you in the foyer. And at the end of the service, take that card filled out, and they'll give you this book, the Bible Promise Book. It's a great book. It has the promises from the Bible in there, all different kinds of promises concerning different topics. And so you'll get one of those. Fill that out. Give it to them in the welcome at the welcome desk in the foyer, and we're glad to have you. The choir's going to sing.
Amen. Let's stand together. We'll sing a chorus. He is Lord, and greet each other this evening. We encourage you to move around and greet someone this evening and say hello. Good to see you here tonight. He is Lord.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
The instruments will keep playing while you're greeting. On that chorus, would you?
He is Lord, he is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
290 in your hymnal, 290. Familiar song, Victory in Jesus. There's no other place to have victory but in the Lord Jesus. Amen. That's where the victory is. Sing it with me.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory. strength and power revealing how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory. Cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. Beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing, and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
All God's people say, amen. Amen. Please be seated. Special music by Lisa.
Sing his praise.
Take your Bible, turn with me to Revelation chapter 8. We're going to let the children for Patch the Pirate Club be dismissed at this time, right up here to the front. Thanks, Eric. I appreciate it. Revelation chapter 8. Again, we always praise the Lord for the children. Amen. A lot of children. Praise the Lord for them. Revelation chapter 8. And we're going to look down at verse 12 there, Revelation chapter 8. I'll actually be reading through chapter 9 and verse 11. So if you can stand with me, if you are able to stand, go ahead and stand with me. I'll begin reading, beginning with verse 12 of chapter 8 in Revelation. And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened. And the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of the heaven, saying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound." And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key to the bottom of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth. And unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle. And on their heads were, as it were, crowns like gold. And their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of a woman, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. They had breastplates, as it were, breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails. And their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. The sounding of the trumpet judgments. When the trumpet judgments sound, God's wrath is going to be poured out upon this earth. And that's going to take place at the second part of the tribulation period. And these things that we're going to see are just terrible things that are going to take place. It talks about the woes, there are three woes. We looked at the seven seals, the seven trumpets. The seventh trumpet will end with seven bowl judgments, and then we see three woes. We'll talk about those. It's just a terrible time. It's just a very terrible time during the tribulation. No one would want their loved ones to be in that place. No one would want anyone to be in that place. It's going to be so terrible. And so we're going to look at this tonight, and
I pray that it would motivate you and help you to see how important it is for us to give the gospel out. These people are giving the gospel out at the fair. We're seeing people saved. But how many more could be saved if we would simply give the gospel out? We need to be motivated to give the gospel out. Amen, we do. And hopefully we will. And to see this destruction, to see how Satan is going to come after people, you know what? He's coming after people today. Amen, he's coming after you and your family and your children. Your marriage. And we're going to see that tonight as we study the book of Revelation and this, and the fourth and the fifth trumpet judgments. Dear Lord, be with this preaching tonight. Stir our hearts. Motivate us to win others to Christ. Father, if just one person in this place tonight would be stirred to be a soul winner, to win others to Christ, Father, it'd be worth it. But I pray that many will be. And then, dear Lord, there may be someone here tonight that needs Christ as their Savior. May they come to know Christ as their Savior before it's eternally too late. Father, save them. Bless in the preaching of your word, and I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Many people live their lives like the construction worker on the high-rise building. He tripped and he fell off the high-rise building. And as he was falling down, he got to about the 21st floor. And someone hollered out, "How are you doing?" He said, "So far, so good." Many people live their lives like that. They think that somehow everything's going to turn out okay. Someone said, "It's not the fall that kills you, it's a sudden stop." You know, there's going to be a sudden stop one day. Do you understand that? It's going to be a sudden stop. And this world will be brought to a place of the judgment of God. The trumpet judgments will bring down God's wrath upon the earth. Now we saw the seven seals God hands, the seven sealed book we see here in the book of Revelation. God will hand the seven sealed book to Jesus. He's the only one that can open that seven sealed book. He begins to open those seals up, and each one brings a judgment. And when he gets to the seventh seal, he opens that seventh seal up, and there's silence, the space of a half hour, the Bible tells us. There's great anticipation of what's going to take place. God's judgment's going to begin to take place here upon this earth. John, the apostle who's writing the book of Revelation under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he sees seven angels with seven trumpets. These trumpets, when they're sounded, will bring judgment. The last trumpet sounded will bring seven bold judgments. Then he sees an angel, and this angel has a golden censer in his hand. The censer is used, the censer was used in the tabernacle or the temple to carry the hot coals and put it on the altar of incense. And he sees this angel, and this angel is actually Christ. And Christ has this golden censer with these hot coals in it, and he takes that censer, that golden censer with the hot coals, and he throws it down towards the earth, and it causes lightning and thunder and a great earthquake. And that great earthquake is a sign for the seven judgments to begin. We looked at the first three trumpet judgments last week. And I don't have time to go into great detail, but with the sounding of the first trumpet, then from heaven will come hail and fire mingled with blood. And this is coming from heaven. You say, what is the blood? And that's from the men and animals that are hit by this fire and hail. And a third part of the trees will be destroyed, a third part of the grass will be destroyed, and of course it's going to cause great suffering here upon the earth. There won't be enough food, there will be a food shortage. Then we see the second trumpet. When that is sounded, then John sees this great mountain that's on fire, and it comes down and it goes into the sea, and it's like an atomic explosion that will take place. And of course, two-thirds of the earth, the surface of the earth, is covered with water. And so all of the earth is going to be affected by that. And the Bible tells us that one third of the seas will be turned into blood, and one third of the seas, the marine life will be killed, and one third of the ships, the commercial vessels, will be destroyed. And so again, that's going to cause great problems here upon the face of the earth, if you can only understand what that would do. We were talking about the thousands of ships that will be sunk as a result of that. Then we see the third trumpet will be sounded, and with that a great star falls from heaven, and they call that star wormwood, which means bitter, unedible. And that will come down, and when it hits the earth's atmosphere, then that's going to be broken up. The Bible says it's going to go into all the streams and the rivers and the water and the aquifers, and it's going to poison it, and man will be poisoned, and man will be sickened or even die as a result of the water. Can you imagine the water being polluted and you can't drink it? That's the third trumpet judgment. That brings us to the fourth trumpet. The sounding of the fourth trumpet. Look at verse 12. And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. So the fourth angel sounds this fourth trumpet. And the Bible says the sun, the moon, and the stars are going to be affected by it. They will be diminished by one-third. One-third sun, one-third stars, one-third moon. And so what's going to happen if we only had a third of the sun? You can just imagine what's going to happen. The temperatures are going to be changed here upon the earth. It'll be cold. It'll be very cold. But it'll be a temporary thing, because the Bible tells us in chapter 16, in verses 8 and 9, that God is going to increase the heat and scorch the earth. And in verses 8 and 9 in chapter 16, and the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and power was given unto him to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat and blasphemed the name of God, which had power over these plagues, and they repented not to give him glory. So, the blowing of this fourth trumpet, then this judgment, a third of the sun, the stars, and the moon are going to be diminished. It's going to affect the weather patterns. It's going to affect the tidal, the tides. Can you imagine the tides, how those are going to change? And it's going to affect the crops once again. The food source will be affected again. Animals will be killed. Men will be killed. Now, this judgment is similar. Notice several things. Number one, it's similar to the plague of darkness there with the plague upon Egypt by Moses in Exodus chapter 10, verses 21 through 23. I know people say, well, this seems to be something. How can these things be? But what's interesting about this is sometimes these things have already occurred. And here it did in Exodus chapter 10, verses 21 through 23. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand toward heaven, and there that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, even darkness which may be felt. And Moses stretched forth his hand toward heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. And they saw not one another, neither rose any from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwelling. So the Bible says that this is something that has happened before. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 6, we see when the seal judgments were opened that this happened there. It was another astronomical event in Revelation chapter 6 in verses 12 through 14. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. So it will happen when the sixth seal is opened, And then the Bible tells us in the latter days it's going to happen again. There are certain passages, other scriptures in Luke chapter 21 and verses 25 through 28. Listen what it says there. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. So the Bible tells us that this is going to take place with the fourth trumpet judgment, but it's already happened with Moses' plagues, and it's going to happen again. It happened with the sixth opening of the sixth seal, and Jesus opened that up. It's going to happen in the latter times before Christ comes for the second advent, when he comes to set his kingdom up upon this earth. That's what it's talking about, that passage. Why is God doing this? Why is God allowing this to happen? It's for one reason, that man might turn to Christ. Amen? God is giving man opportunity. Men are having the opportunity to come to trust in Christ as their Savior. He just wants man to say yes. I was reading a story. It's kind of a humorous story about a fellow by the name of Ted Kidd. His girlfriend's name was Janet. Ted Kidd and Janet. They had been going together for 7 years. He was 5 years older than her, and they both graduated from college, and he was working a job more than 100 miles away from her. Every year on Valentine's Day, he would take her out to dinner, and he would ask her to marry him. And every year, she would say, "No, I'm not ready yet," for 7 years. And so he decided on the next Valentine's Day, he was going to ask her one last time. And if she said no, then he thought, well, it's best that we part our ways and go another way. And so he went down, and I don't know why he didn't do this before, but he went down and bought a diamond ring. Maybe that would have been the trick. He should have probably done that. I try not to be too logical when I read stories like that, you know, because I don't know this guy, and it's too late anyway. But nonetheless, he went down, bought a diamond ring, and he invited her to dinner. And by this time, now they were living in Texas. Both of them were living in Texas. And so he called the restaurant, got a nice restaurant. They went to eat, and they had their salads and had their main course. They had their dessert. And then he was working the courage up one last time to ask her to marry him. This is going to be the last time. He was working his courage up. He was about to ask her, and then all of a sudden she said, "I've got something for you." He said, "You do?" And she said, "Yes." And she pulled this box out of her purse, and it was in the shape of a book. It was a box in the shape of a book, and she handed it to him. And it was all wrapped up, and so he unwrapped that package, and he opened it up, and he pulled it out, and it was a cross stitch that she had stitched. And when he unfolded it, he looked at it, and it had one word on it: yes. Yes. And so she had already answered him, and it had a happy ending. But you know, that's what God is looking forward to, man saying yes. Amen. God wants man to say, "Yes, I will receive you as my Savior." Yes. That's what God is trying to get man to say, yes. We see the sounding of the fourth trumpet. Now, the sounding of the fifth trumpet, look at this. This is something. Beginning with verse 9. Excuse me, beginning with verse 13 of chapter 8 through chapter 9, verse 11. And I beheld, because this is going to take me a lot of explaining tonight. Follow along with me. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound. Chapter 9, verse 1, and the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men, and they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions, and they had breastplates as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle, and they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months, and they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name is in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. You go, wow, what in the world? Oh, man, this is no fairy tale. This is really going to happen. Let me explain it to you. The fifth angel sounds the trumpet. Notice this is the first of three woes. You say, what in the world is a woe? What do you think it is? Woe. Condemnation. Judgment. And destruction. That's what it is. Man, these are bad times. Not only is the trumpet judgment, these are woes that are going to happen. I mean, this is bad. This is bad stuff. This judgment vows a number of different things. First of all, look at verse number 1. It says, there's an unnamed star. What in the world is this unnamed star? And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given. And to him, did you get that? And to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. So the star falls from heaven, the Bible says, and it uses the pronoun him to refer to the star. So that star is a person. A star is a symbolic way of referring to a person of fame. And so this is a person falling from heaven, a very famous person of high position falling from heaven. Who is that? Satan. It's Satan. It's talking about Satan. You said, what in the world? This is talking about Satan when he was cast out of heaven. You say, how do you know that? Well, I'm going to tell you. I'm not going to just say that's what it is. I'm going to tell you why it's Satan. Number one. It says that the star fell out of heaven, past tense. So this is something that happened before the tribulation period and before the second part of the tribulation period. The Bible tells us that Christ saw Satan fall from heaven in Luke chapter 10 and verse 18. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Jesus saw him fall from heaven. The scriptures describe Satan's fall In Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 15. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which does weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be as like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. It's Satan. Satan is given the keys to the bottomless pit, the abyss, the Bible tells us. He's not over hell. He's going to be in hell. He's given the key because he doesn't have the key. God has the key. Did you know the name Lucifer literally means brightness? He is the star that falls from heaven. So first of all, it's talking about Satan falling when he fell. Now God gives latitude to Satan in his dealings with evil, but it's to carry out his righteous judgments. Understand that. So God will use him. First of all, there will be an unnamed star. That's Satan. Number two, there will be a bottomless pit. Look at verse number two. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there rose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. This is a place where fallen angels have been kept. Devils, if you would. Devils or demons, as some people call them, are fallen angels. They're kept in this place, this pit, or this abyss. Their final doom will be Gehenna Hell, where they will be cast into Gehenna Hell with the devil, with the Antichrist, the false prophet, and all of the unsaved will be cast into the lake of fire, Gehenna Hell. Revelation 20:10. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. God has chosen to incarcerate these certain devils, to place them in this pit for punishment. Why? 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 4. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. Why would he put these certain, there are fallen angels around, there are devils around, there are demons around, we know that. Why are these devils put into this place of abyss? I can suggest this to you, I believe they're the worst ones. I believe they're so bad that they can't even be here today. They're so bad that they would bring destruction. And so that's why God put them there. They're the worst of the worst. They're all bad, but these are the worst. they're perverted, and they're so vile, and they're so wicked that God could not allow them to be here. The devil and his fallen angels are bad enough, but these are worse. God has locked them up until that day. The day that we're going to look at. And they're going to be set free. They're going to be released in that day. I thought to myself, how can I illustrate that? I thought, well, if you could take all of the prisons, think of all the prisons in America, and let out all of the prisoners. We open the jails up. Of the murderers and the rapists. And the most ungodly people, we say, we're going to let you all go free. What kind of world would this be? What kind of country would ours be? We just let them all out. You say, well, man alive, that'd be scary business. It would, wouldn't it? But that's nothing compared to letting these devils out of the pit. None of us would want to be here. Man, we'd put bars on our windows, you know. Because all of those people, they'd be robbing and raping and killing. You just let them run the streets. Nobody's going to arrest them. They just go and do whatever they want to do. Wow, that's scary. That's going to happen in this day. These are devils. And wait till you see these people. These angels, these fallen angels. I shouldn't call them people. Number three, there will be the locust-like devils from the abyss in verses 3 through 6. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and to them was given the power as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. Now that's important. And to them was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of scorpions when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from him. Out of the smoke of the abyss will come these devils resembling locusts, locust-like devils. Locusts in the Bible are always a symbol of God's anger against the ungodly and the evil world. In Exodus chapter 10 and verse 13, and Moses stretched forth his rod over the land of Egypt, and the Lord brought an east wind upon the land all that day and all that night. And when it was morning, the east wind brought locusts. Joel chapter 1 and verse 4, that which the pommel worm had left hath the locust eaten, and that which the locust hath left hath the cankerworm eaten, and that which the cankerworm hath left hath the caterpillar eaten. God uses them for judgment, and these locust-like devils are going to be used for judgment upon the earth. Notice the judgment that these locust-like devils will bring. First of all, the locust-like devils will be given scorpion-like power in their tails. In verse 3, and there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. Scorpions have power in their tails. They strike with their tails, and they inflict wounds on their victim. Doesn't kill, but it makes them very sick. The locust-like devils will be restrained from damaging the nature, the Bible says in verse 4. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. So locust-like devils are not going to be like the locust today that will destroy the grass and the fields and so forth, but they're going to be attacking men. They're not going to be feeding on the vegetation. And that's the next point. The locust-like devils are to afflict only people, and only people that don't have the seal of God. In verse number 4, the Bible says, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. When people get saved during the tribulation period, God is going to somehow put a mark on their forehead. You know, the unsaved are going to have the mark 666. Mark of the beast. They're going to have that mark, but those that get saved will have the mark of God. And I can't understand all of that, but I'm telling you, they're going to have some mark. You'll be able to tell those who are saved, those who are unsaved. Those that have the mark of God upon their forehead, these scorpions are not going to touch them. They're only going to touch the unsaved, those people that have the mark of the beast on them. They're going to go after them. Yes, there will be people that will be saved during the tribulation period, but my friend, you know, you can't wait till the tribulation period to get saved, you know? You can't. Believers are going to be afflicted. You say, well, they're not going to die by these locust-like devils. Yeah, but the Antichrist is going to come after them. If you're saved, you're going to have the mark of God upon you, and you know what? The Antichrist is going to come after all of those people. It's going to be remarkable if they don't all get killed. There will be some that will be alive, because we know that after the Battle of Armageddon and when Christ comes to set his millennial kingdom up, there will be people that have that are still alive that will go into the millennial kingdom. But my friend, it's not going to be an easy time to be here. God's wrath is going to fall upon unbelievers. It always has. Revelation chapter 7 and verses 2 and 3, "And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, Hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till they have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads." Ezekiel chapter 9, verses 4 through 6, "And the Lord said unto him, Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men and that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. Verse 5, "And to the others he said in mine hearing, Go ye after him through the city and smite, and let your eyes spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house." Then these locusts like devils, they're not going to kill the people, they're only going to torment them. In verse 5, "And to them was given that they should not kill them, but that they should torment them 5 months, and their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man." These locust-like devils have these scorpion-like tails, and they're going to go after the unsaved, and they're going to strike them, and they're going to torment them. They won't die, but my friend, they're going to be tormented. But God only does it for 5 months, allows it to happen for 5 months. Why? Because God shows mercy on them because he wants them to get saved. You know what? He wants them to repent. Look at verses 20 and 21. It says, "And the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of their works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk, neither repented they of their murders, nor their sorceries, nor their fornication, nor of their thefts." They will refuse to repent. Even after all of that. Can you imagine that? Man, if I saw a devil creature coming after me, a locust-like devil coming after me, I'd be running. You know what? I'd be doing whatever I could. But they're not going to. The result of the torment upon the people will be so agonizing and so excruciating that people will want to die. But they won't be able to. Look at verse 6. "And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them." They won't be able to die. They'll try to die, but they won't be able to die. God won't let them die. And I thought of that from every angle. I thought, you know, how can that be? But I can't understand it all, but I can just know that that's what the Bible says, and I'm going to believe it. You know what? My thinking is this. God's going to let them live because God wants to give them one more chance to get saved. Amen? One more chance. If they die, then it's all over with. You understand that? If they die, it's done for. Amen? There's no more chances. God's given them an opportunity, one more opportunity to get saved. They're wanting to kill themselves, and he stops them from killing themselves so that they have one more chance to get saved. One more chance. They'll try to die, but they won't be able to. We look at the appearance of these locust-like devils in verses 7 through 10. Someone was telling me just today, they were saying to me, well, they've got these new helicopters, that might be a helicopter. You know what? I think they're just what the Bible says they are. They're fallen angels. Amen? I'm not going to explain it away. Bible says they're fallen angels come out of the abyss. Brother, they're fallen angels coming out of the abyss. I'm not going to explain it away. You say, well, how can you believe all that stuff? I believe the whole Bible. Amen? I didn't believe the cover because it says Holy Bible. Look at the description given here. And verses 7 through 10, and the shapes of the locusts are like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men, and they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions, and they had breastplates as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots and many horses running to battle, and they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt five men 5 months. So did you count that? There's eight descriptions given here. They were shaped like horses. They have crowns on their heads made of gold. They have faces like men. They have hair like women. They have teeth like a lion. They have breastplates of iron. They have wings that sound like many chariots rushing into battle. They have scorpion tails on them. Man, that's pretty scary looking. Pretty scary. You'd think that people would see something like that and they'd trust in Christ. You know what? But they're not. Then notice this. There will be a king of the locust-like devils. Now, some people said, well, I thought that'd be the Satan himself. No, not Satan himself. Look at verse 11. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. He's an angel, but it's not Satan. Satan is the prince and power of the air, not of the abyss. Ephesians 2:2, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and power of the air. That's Satan, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. This angel is a high-ranking devil, angel in Satan's hierarchy. There's a hierarchy. His name is Abaddon and Apollyon. That's because in Hebrew it's Abaddon, and Greek it's Apollyon. But it means the same thing. You know what it means? Destroyer. He's a destroyer. Satan is a destroyer. He's a destroyer. Satan wants to destroy us. He's seeking to destroy us. He wants to destroy you. He wants to destroy your family. He wants to destroy your marriage. He wants to destroy your children. He wants to destroy this church. He's a destroyer. Don't be naive, folks. You know, he's so obvious. He's so obvious in what he does. Listen, he's been using the same things from the beginning of the world. Same stuff. You would think that we would have learned about it by now. But he continues. We continue to be fooled. It's so obvious what he does, isn't it? Isn't it obvious? I mean, the drinking, the drugs, the pornography, the same old stuff. And he keeps using it. And you know what? He keeps getting people with it. You think, hey, aren't we smarter than that? Haven't we seen enough heartache and enough heartbreak? Haven't we seen enough? But he continues to use the same traps. And we continue to fall for the same stuff. And he continues to destroy people. The jails are filled. Hospitals. The same stuff. He wants to destroy you. He's the destroyer. He's going to destroy during that time. And he's going to try to destroy you right now. How many families have we seen destroyed? Right here at Liberty Baptist Church. How many? There's hardly a week that goes by that somebody doesn't say, whatever happened to so-and-so? And it just makes me sick to even have to say it. I have to say, it's a long story. Whatever happened to so-and-so? The old destroyer. The old devil. The Chicago Tribune had a story about a lady that came home from work one night, and she went into her apartment there in Chicago. And when she opened the door up, you know, when you open your door up, if there's, you can smell what's going on. I like on Sunday when my wife is cooking something with a crock pot. You know, I like to open that door. Oh, it smells so good. Just smells so good. A roast, a nice roast with the potatoes and the carrots and all of that in there, you know. You open that door and you go, oh. You can hardly wait to change your Sunday clothes. Once, I was a couple of weeks ago, it smelled so good, I said, let's just eat with our Sunday clothes on. Now that, I don't know if I've ever done that before, but I said to her, let's just eat with our Sunday clothes on. She said, okay. And we ate. And it was so good. I thought, you know, we ought to do this more often. This lady opened the door up. And when she opened that door, immediately she smelled gas fumes. You know, like smell of gas. She thought, there's something not right here. So she called the landlord of the apartment, and she said, I opened the door up, and I smelled some gas fumes. I'm wondering, if was something going on? Did someone go into my apartment? And the landlord said, no, I'll send the custodian up. She sent the custodian up. He came in, and he could just barely smell the gas fumes, and he said, well, maybe we ought to dial 911 before we go any further. So they called 911. The police came. The firemen came. And they said, we smell some gas fumes in here, and we, you know, no one's been in here that we know of. Why is there gas fumes in here? And they said, well, you just stay out here, and we'll go check the apartment out. They went through the apartment, the firemen and the policemen, they went through the apartment, and they said, we didn't see anything. We didn't see anything unusual. They said, we can't tell you what it was. But after all those people have been in there, you know, it didn't smell so strong any longer. And so they all left, and they said, well, if you find anything, then give us a call. And so everybody left. The lady had some dinner, and then she was getting ready for bed. It was about 10:30 at night. She was getting ready for bed. She went, and as she was getting ready to go to bed, she noticed that there was an extension cord going under her bed. She said, that wasn't there before. There's an extension cord under my bed. What's that from? I didn't put an extension cord. And then she looked at her bed, and her bed had kind of a lump on the top of it. There was a lump on her bed. She said, wow, why didn't I see that before? It's very obvious. There's a lump on my bed. There's an extension cord going under my bed. So she went and called 911, and the police came, and the fire department came, and she said, there's an extension cord going under my bed, and there's a lump on my bed. And they said, well, clear the apartment. And so the fire department, they brought the bomb squad in. They brought the bomb squad in. And they gingerly pulled that, you know, the top cover of the bedspread. They pulled that off. And they began to pull the covers and then the sheet. They pulled all of that off. And they didn't see anything. And then they very gently picked the mattress. You've got a mattress and a box spring. They picked the mattress up. And when they picked that mattress up, they found a homemade bomb. It was between the mattress and the box spring. Let me tell you, it was Someone had taken a hot plate and they put three milk jugs of gasoline on top of the hot plate. And they had an extension cord that was hooked into a timer that was set for 3 o'clock in the morning. It's in the Chicago Tribune. Someone was going to try to blow her up. You go, wow, I can't believe it. But she said it was so obvious to see this lump on the top of the bed, to see the extension cord, she would have had to be oblivious to the world not to see that, you see? It was so subtle. I thought to myself, isn't that just like the devil? He is so subtle. We have to be oblivious to the world not to see what he's trying to do. Don't you see what he's trying to do, folks? Can't you see it? We can see what he's trying to do. I think that sometimes we stick our heads in the sand and we don't want to see it any longer. But my friend, we need to wake up. He wants to destroy you and he wants to destroy your family, your husband, your wife, your marriage, your children. Guard your children. I praise the Lord that my parents, when they raised us up, they sheltered us from the world. People say, we don't want to shelter our kids. I say, shelter your kids. Man, when I was in college, I didn't even know what some stuff was all about, and I was glad about it. I wish I never knew now. Amen? Right. Satan's coming after us. The trumpet judgments will bring down God's wrath upon the earth. It's pretty scary stuff, isn't it? Let's bow our heads, every head bowed, every eye closed. You need to make sure, first of all, that you're saved tonight. Without Christ, you have no power, no defense against Satan whatsoever. You'll be condemned to hell just like he is. Do you know that you're saved? Do you know that you're on your way to heaven? Are you sure about that tonight? How many could say by the uplifted hand, I'm sure I'm saved and on my way to heaven, I'm glad of it. Stick your hand up in the air if you're saved and you're glad of it. Thank you very much. Amen. Would you say tonight, you know, I couldn't raise my hand and I'm not sure I'm